Listening Library presents Tales from Lovecraft Middle School, Professor Gargoyle, the Slither Sisters, and Teacher's Pest by Charles Gilman. Read for you by Kristoffer Tabori. Book 1. Professor Gargoyle. Chapter 1. Robert Arthur was surrounded by strangers. He stood outside the entrance to Lovecraft Middle School, watching the students pass by, searching for a familiar face. Everybody was talking to someone. Kids were joking and laughing and goofing around, but Robert didn't recognize a single person. Earlier that summer, his neighborhood had been redistricted. This was a fancy way of saying that all of his old friends were attending Franklin Middle School in the north part of town, but somehow Robert got stuck attending Lovecraft Middle School in the south part of town. His mother told him there was no say in the matter. It was just the luck of the draw. "But you're going to love it," she promised. "They spent millions of dollars building this school. It's brand new, state-of-the-art, with a swimming pool and digital chalkboards and everything. Oh, it's such an incredible opportunity." Robert wasn't so sure. He would have happily traded the swimming pool and digital chalkboards for the chance to be with his old friends. He had 100 different worries. Who would sit with him at lunch? What if he needed help opening his locker? Wasn't anybody from his old school here? Beside the main entrance of the school was a large digital billboard with an animated message. "Welcome, students. Please report to the athletic arena for the ribbon-cutting ceremony." It might have been faster to walk through the building, but Robert wasn't in a hurry. He took his time, circling the outside of the school, marveling at how quickly it seemed to have sprung from the earth. 6 months earlier, this was all abandoned farmland, full of weeds and mud puddles and sticker bushes. Now there was a four-story classroom building, tennis courts, a baseball diamond, and lush green grass as far as the eye could see. When Robert reached the athletic stadium, the bleachers were packed with spectators, students, teachers, parents, news reporters. Everyone in town had come to witness the ribbon-cutting ceremony. Everyone except Robert's mother, a nurse who worked the early shift at Dunwich Memorial Hospital. Most mornings she was out the door before Robert woke up, so she rarely attended school presentations or class trips. Sometimes this bothered Robert, but today he was grateful. He knew the only thing more embarrassing than sitting alone at his new middle school would be sitting with his mommy. All the other kids were sitting with their friends. Robert climbed halfway up the bleachers and squeezed between two clusters of giggling girls. He tried smiling at them. None of the girls smiled back. The ribbon-cutting ceremony was already underway. First the mayor thanked the governor, then the governor stood up and thanked the teachers' union, then a bunch of teachers got up and thanked the parents' association, then a bunch of parents cheered and thanked Principal Slater. Finally, Principal Slater stood up with oversized scissors and sliced the long green ribbon in half. At precisely that moment, the clouds turned gray, and a low drum of thunder rolled across the sky. It was weird, Robert thought. Just 1 minute ago, it had been a perfectly pleasant and sunny day. Now suddenly, it looked like rain. Fortunately, the ceremony was almost over. The grand finale was a special performance by the Dunwich High School marching band, complete with drums, brass, and color guard. They paraded across the field playing "The Stars and Stripes Forever." Robert glanced over his shoulder, peering up at the bleachers, scanning the faces. There must have been 400 kids in the arena. He knew that sooner or later he'd have to recognize someone. And then he did. the worst possible someone. Oh, no! Robert immediately faced forward, but it was too late. He'd been spotted.
Hey, Robert! Is that you? Robert Arthur?
He couldn't believe his rotten luck. Glenn Torkels. The one person he knew at Lovecraft Middle School, and it was Glenn Torkels, the bully who had tormented him for years.
Robert! I'm talking to you!
Definitely Glenn Torkels. Robert tried ignoring him. His mother used to tell him to ignore the bullies, and eventually they would leave him alone. Yeah, right.
I know that's you, Robert. I got a real good memory, and I never forget a face.
Something slimy hit the back of Robert's neck. He reached up and peeled it off. A half-chewed gummy worm.
Turn around and look at me!
Robert knew that Glenn would get what he wanted sooner or later. Glenn always did. Robert turned around and another gummy worm struck him right in the forehead.
Glenn laughed uproariously. Bullseye!
He was seated, two rows behind Robert, looking much like he did back in elementary school, only bigger. He wore the same green army jacket and the same grubby blue jeans. His dark blonde hair was still plastered to his forehead, still looking like he'd cut it himself with dull scissors. Glenn had always been the biggest kid in the class, but over the summer he'd ballooned into the Incredible Hulk.
"What do you want?"
Robert asked. Glenn popped a gummy worm into his mouth and began working his jaw.
"Dweeb tax," he said. "Pay up."
Robert sighed. Glenn had been collecting the dweeb tax for part of fifth grade and all of sixth. It was a $1 penalty he imposed on Robert for various infractions, tripping or stammering or wearing ugly pants or other crimes that Glenn dreamed up. Robert glanced around, hoping to spot a teacher who might intervene. That never happened at his last school, but he thought maybe Lovecraft Middle School would be different. No such luck. Everyone was watching the marching band on the field. The girls on either side of Robert were chattering among themselves.
"Hurry up, nerd Bert," Glenn said. "You think you're the only kid in the school who owes me?"
Earlier that morning, Robert's mother had given him an extra $5 of spending money to celebrate his first day as a middle school student. Robert retrieved one of those dollars and passed it to Glenn. His tormentor shook his head and smiled, revealing flecks of chewed-up gummy worm in his teeth.
"It's gonna be $2 here in middle school," Glenn explained. "We're not little kids anymore."
Chapter 2. After the marching band had finished playing, Principal Slater directed the students to find their lockers and then proceed to their homerooms. As the bleachers emptied, Robert moved nimbly through the crowd, careful to stay several steps ahead of Glenn Torkels. He noticed a girl hurrying alongside him. Looking at him. She was short and skinny, dressed in a white t-shirt and blue jeans, and carrying a beat-up skateboard. She had dark brown hair that fell past her shoulders and wore a dozen jangling bracelets on her wrists. She smiled, revealing a mouthful of metal braces.
"You got worms in your hair," she said.
"Excuse me?"
"Gummy worms in your scalp."
Robert reached up and shook them loose. "Thanks. You're going to have to stand up to him."
"Stand up to who?"
"You know who." Robert flushed. Was there anything more embarrassing than getting advice on bullies from a cute girl?
"Glenn and I are friends," Robert quickly explained. "That's just a stupid game we play. I owed him $2.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.